Happy National Science Week. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. My name is Kate Green and I'm part of the communications team here at Ames, and we're very excited to be sharing some of our science from below the sea with you this week. Before we go any further, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the Ames sites in Townsville, Darwin, Perth and Canberra, and pay our respect to them as the first scientists in this land, and acknowledge the important contribution this wisdom provides to contemporary scientific conversations and collaborations. We acknowledge the deep and timeless connection between Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, their land and sea country, and pay our respects to elders past and present, and acknowledge the future leaders of tomorrow. We are AIMS, the Australian Institute of Marine Science, the nation's tropical marine research agency. We work in the tropical waters of Northern Australia, from Ningaloo over on the west coast, across to the Top End and down to the Southern Great Barrier Reef on the Australia's east coast. We have offices in Townsville, Darwin and Perth and have been studying these waters for nearly 50 years. And our research began here on the Great Barrier Reef. I'm speaking to you from Townsville today. We deliver marine research that improves ocean health and protects coral reefs from climate change and help create economic, social and environmental benefits for all Australians. We are so pleased to have Dr. Renee Gruber with us here today, taking us through AIMS work on water quality on the Great Barrier Reef. Renee is a biological chemical oceanographer and specialises in coastal and estuarine waters, studying the links between the physical environment, such as waves and tides, and the biological and chemical responses. She has worked in diverse coastal environments such as Chesapeake Bay in the United States, the coastal lakes in New South Wales, and islands in the Kimberley region of Western Australia. Now, at the end of Renee's talk today, we're going to open it up to a few question and answers.
Thanks, Kate. Hi, everybody. This is very cool. So I've never done a webinar before. Normally, if we did a presentation like this, you know, people would be there and we could talk back and forth and have some, you know, discussion. So this will be a little bit different, but hopefully it's very informative and interesting for you. So I'm just going to share my screen. Okay, so today I'm going to discuss water quality monitoring that AIMS is doing on the Great Barrier Reef. And this talk is not going to be a comprehensive look at all the monitoring that's happening on the reef. There's many different groups doing all types of monitoring, but this is going to be looking at some of the programs that AIMS is involved in, and then look at some of the information that we can get from data that we're collecting in these programs. So today I'm going to talk about why we need to monitor water quality, what the purpose of this monitoring is. I'll discuss who is doing the monitoring. I'll give a definition of water quality. I'll do some show and tell behind the scenes of how we actually go out and collect these data in the marine environment. And then finally, I'll give some examples of the types of information that we can gather from the data that we're collecting. So water quality is really important. As you may know, the Great Barrier Reef World Heritage Area has many important and iconic ecosystems, including things like coral reefs and seagrass meadows. So these communities have intrinsic value on their own, but they also support important things like fisheries, tourism activities, social and cultural and recreational activities. So water quality supports the health and productivity of these communities, and that's why we need to monitor and understand it. Water quality monitoring provides useful information on the status and trends of the marine environment over time. Monitoring can help us understand the impacts of local pressures. So that could be things like extreme river discharge events. So up in the top right, this is a satellite image from the 2019 flood events that happened near Townsville. So this image shows the Burdekin River plume extending out into the mid-shelf reef, and then some phytoplankton blooms that are occurring as a result of nutrients coming out from river discharge. So this would be a type of episodic local pressure that's occurring. Also, it could be things like cyclones, disturbances, coastal development activities, or dredging. Monitoring also helps us understand the impact of global pressures on the marine environment. So this could be things like ocean warming and acidification, which result from global climate change. And it's important to note that to really have valuable monitoring information, we need to collect data in the long term. So if you go out and collect measurements once or twice, that will give you a snapshot of what was happening at that particular place and time, but you won't be able to understand the broader context of water quality in that area and how it's changing over years to decades. So things like cyclones, for example, may come along and do some damage to reef or seagrass habitats. So the recovery of those ecological communities may occur over many years. So it's important that we monitor water quality to understand how water quality may enhance or impede that recovery from disturbance, as an example. Monitoring is also important because we use this info to provide people like the public, the government, environmental management agencies, universities, very broad, many different types of stakeholders. This info is very valuable for them in understanding the marine environment of the reef. So who is doing the monitoring? So today I'm going to talk about two programs in particular that AIMS is involved with. The first is the Marine Monitoring Program for Inshore Water Quality. And this program is a collaboration between the Marine Park Authority, AIMS, James Cook University, Cowley Environmental Consulting, and the Cape York Water Monitoring Partnership. So this program has been running since 2005, and its aim is to monitor the status and trends of the inshore reef, water quality on the inshore reef in relation to pressures. So I'll just give some overview of where this program is operating in the reef space. The MMP is mostly looking at the inshore zone. So when I say inshore zone, I'm referring to the lagoon area of the reef that's closer to shore. So you'll often hear the Great Barrier Reef described as being inshore, mid-shelf, and offshore environments. So the inshore is the closer to shore part of the shelf. And the actual size of this varies depending where you are on the reef. So further south, the outer reefs are located further offshore. So that inshore zone is wider. And then as we go north, the outer reefs are closer to shore. So that inshore zone is narrower. So the MMP mostly operates in the inshore zone, although we do have several sites in the mid-shelf as well. And you can see that the program is operating over a very broad swath of the coast, over 1,000 kilometers of coastline from the Pasco River up here in Cape York, all the way down to the Whitsunday region. We do routine water quality monitoring at almost 60 stations, which are shown on the right, and these sites are visited between 3 and 12 times every year. James Cook University also undertakes an event-based sampling program that goes out and targets specific flood or high rainfall events to look at the impact of these on the reef. And then we have a logging, a network of loggers. So these are instruments that are permanently moored out on the reef in different locations, which are shown in pink. The other program I'm going to talk about today is the Integrated Marine Observing System. So this is a partnership of many different universities and government agencies, which are shown down on the left. And this program is aimed at monitoring marine waters all around Australia, not just in the reef. On the right, you can see all the areas that IMOS is operating in. So everywhere from temperate regions down south to tropical marine waters in the north. In the Great Barrier Reef region, we're very fortunate to have several different IMOS facilities. So there's a series of IMOS moorings that are located on outer shelf areas as well as mid-shelf and inner shelf areas. We're very fortunate to have a national reference station in the reef, and this is located at the Yongala Dive Wreck, which is close to Townsville or offshore of the Burdekin. And this, a national reference station, there are several of these around the country. And at these stations, IMOS undertakes monitoring of biological and chemical variables. So they have very high quality, high frequency time series of these variables. And then there's a series of other observing and network stations located in the GBR. So how do we define water quality? I'm going to talk in depth about each of these broad classifications, but the monitoring programs we are discussing today monitor physical variables. So that includes things like temperature, salinity, clarity, and stratification. It also includes biological variables. So things like chlorophyll, total suspended material that's in the water column, and phytoplankton groups. And then things like chemical variables as well. So we monitor a broad range of chemical constituents, including dissolved, particulate, and carbon constituents, and dissolved organic matter. So how do we actually go out and monitor these variables? So for physical variables, we often use instruments to collect these data. So what you see on the right here is one of the most common, most important instruments. It's really the workhorse of oceanography. So this is a conductivity temperature depth profiler. We use these to monitor things like temperature, salinity. They can also have other sensors attached to measure a broad suite of other variables. And they're lowered from the surface all the way to the bottom. So that allows us to understand vertically what the conditions in the ocean are. We use them to understand the structure of the ocean, so how stratified it is, for example. So a stratified water column is one where the surface and bottom waters are not mixing well, so you may have fresher or warmer and or warmer water that's on the surface and cooler and or denser water located at the bottom, and these waters are not mixing very well. So using profiles like this can help us understand the structure of the ocean. We also monitor these variables using time series instruments. So we have a series of loggers which are located out on the reef monitoring temperature and salinity. And on the bottom, you can see one of these instruments. It's been prepared. It's about to go out and be placed on a mooring. And then at the top, you can see one of our instruments. This is what they look like when they come back from their deployment at sea. So they spend about 4 months at sea. It's a very inhospitable environment out there. So we prepare them very carefully for that. And it's important to note that the actual measurement, the face, the sensor face, so the part of the instrument that's actually taking a measurement, is not being fouled by this biofouling. So we prepare them in advance so that they're still collecting clean and accurate data throughout their entire deployment. So now I'm going to show just an example of how we do this. So this video is from the Marine Monitoring Program, and Irina is preparing some of these instruments to go out to sea. You can see that she's wrapping them very carefully, making sure that the measurement faces or the sensors are protected from any fouling. The gray thing there that Neil is pointing to, this is a frame. So this is going to protect the instruments as they're sitting on the mooring. The team has laid out a new mooring here that they're going to use to replace the mooring that they're going out to retrieve. So the MMP has a series of moorings that are located near important river mouths all up and down the coast. And this mooring in particular has been out for about 4 months. So the team is going to retrieve the entire mooring and do some servicing on it, as well as collect the instruments. Most of the work that we do in the Marine Monitoring Program is done with our small vessels, but in the case of mooring retrievals, we require heavy lifting capabilities. So the vessel that the team is on is one of Ames's research vessels, the RV Cape Ferguson. So this is the mooring, the surface float from the mooring just coming up now. The team is going to now retrieve the instruments off of the mooring itself. And these instruments are going to be cleaned, carefully downloaded. They'll be validated with data that's taken at the same time that we collect by hand. And after every 12 months, we send them off to be factory calibrated and serviced. So they receive the most high quality servicing that you can really do for these instruments. So these data will then be downloaded and analyzed and reported on in the program. So we also take some measurements of physical variables by hand. What I'm showing here are secchi disk depths. This is a very old way to measure water clarity. So we basically lower these disks until you can no longer see the difference between the black and white quadrants. And in this example, we're looking at some reefs during that flood event I talked about earlier. So on the left is a reef that's not being impacted by floodwaters, and on the right is a reef that's experiencing a plankton bloom due to heavy loads of nutrients coming in from river discharge. So secchi depth is just one way that we use to measure water clarity, and some of you may be familiar with that from your own experiences on monitoring programs. So now I'll just show an example of what we may use mooring data, ways that we may use mooring data. So this is from the IMOS mooring network. So what I'm showing here is a 10-year time series of ocean temperature, and this is an outer shelf mooring that's located off of Townsville. And this is also showing with depth on the vertical. So we're looking down in the water column over 10 years. These data can help us understand how marine heat waves develop, for example. So they can help us understand what the oceanographic drivers of heat waves are. So what aspects may enhance or suppress marine heat waves. And this information can help us in forecasting events like marine heat waves and also around spatial planning. So here's an example from these cut from that time series. So on the left, we see a normal year. This is what temperature looks like at this site in a normal year. So during the dry season, we have cooler, more purple temperatures developing. Once we head into the wet season, we can see warmer surface waters occurring. That's the hotter or yellower colors. And then as we progress through the wet season, the water's warming further and becoming well mixed as we reach the end of the wet season. So that's what a normal year would look like. On the right, we can see 2015-16, which was a year where we had a very extreme marine heat wave, and this caused a mass coral bleaching event that many of you may be familiar with. So you can see during the wet season, in contrast to the image on the left, we have much hotter conditions developing midway through the wet season, and these are also mixed all the way through the water column. So this warm water is vertically well mixed through the water column. And this led to a mass bleaching event, as I said. So this kind of data can help us really understand how things like bleaching events or ecological community die-off, how they happen, how to predict them, and how to understand better the drivers. So now I'll talk about biological variables that we monitor. So we do monitor these with instruments as well. So one important parameter we monitor is fluorescence, which is a proxy for chlorophyll A. So chlorophyll A is the green pigment that's found in all plants and also in phytoplankton. So when we have, for example, heavy rainfall, we have nutrients washing out from the catchments into the ocean. And these nutrients, phytoplankton use to grow. And when that happens, we can have very green waters developing, like in the case here. This is what we would call a phytoplankton bloom. We also monitor turbidity, or the cloudiness of the water. So this is a function of how many particles are present in the water column. This can be often as very fine sediments like muds and clays, as well as particulate material that's floating in the water column. So I'll just show you how we monitor some of these information. So again, this is footage from the marine monitoring program, and Mike is going to demonstrate exchanging some of these instruments. So this is one of our sites at Magnetic Island. And this is an instrument that has been recently cleaned and prepared for deployment. So it's all ready to go out and sit on the reef for about 4 months monitoring conditions there. So these instruments are mounted on the reef. And the reason that we do this is because we want to measure what conditions in terms of phytoplankton and turbidity. What conditions is the reef actually seeing or experiencing? These instruments record very high frequency. So about every 10 minutes, they're recording these parameters and logging them. Again, these instruments, like the ones I showed before, are prepared very carefully prior to being deployed so that the sensors are always recording clean and accurate data. And this instrument uses what's called a wiper, which is basically cleaning the sensor face every single time it takes a measurement. So that's what the divers here are checking to make sure that the instrument is operating properly and the wiper is working. So we also take measurements of these same parameters by hand, chlorophyll, suspended solids, and we take measurements of the plankton community itself. So these are done by identifying taxonomically what plankton are present and in what quantities. And this work is done by a team at CSIRO. So now I'm going to show some examples of how we might use these time series data. This example comes from, again, that flood event I was talking about last year. So up in the right-hand corner, we can see modeling from e-reef sets showing where river material from the Burdekin River ended up throughout the 2018-2019 wet season. So you can see the area around the river mouth has much higher amounts of river material, and then as we're moving up the coast, that material is being diluted. So our loggers can help us understand what conditions reefs are actually experiencing in relation to events like this. So here we're looking at turbidity or water cloudiness from a logger that's located at the river mouth. So we can see earlier in the wet season, we had some smaller river discharge events, and then the wet season tends to have higher turbidity overall. During February, this was when these flood events happened. So we have extremely high turbidity levels occurring during this time, and the sensor is actually maxing out here. So the turbidity levels are really getting much, much higher than this. And this is due to sediments and other particulate material that's washing off of the land and entering the marine environment. So now we'll look at a logger. This is actually the logger we just saw being exchanged in the last video. This is at Magnetic Island. So we can see during the same flood event, this reef experienced very high turbidity levels. And this is not just from the Burdekin River, it's also from the Ross River. There was extensive flooding happening from the Ross River as well. But this reef is experiencing turbidity levels much, much higher than what it would normally experience. So turbidity on reefs is normally less than about 5 NTU. So that would be down here. So these levels are quite elevated due to this flood event. If we look at a reef that's slightly further away, this is in the Palms group, you can see that this reef is sort of outside the major area that's being impacted by river discharge. So we see slightly higher turbidity levels during this event, but they're not anywhere near what's being experienced by Magnetic Island. So as material, I said before, that heavier sediments or heavier material tends to settle out of the water column closer to river mouths, and then lighter material like muds and clays can be transported a further distance away. So what you're seeing is both the dilution and settlement of particles as water is moving along the coast. So the inshore zone is very dynamic. Reefs are experiencing a wide range of conditions depending on what's happening throughout the year, where they're located, etc. So this monitoring can help us understand what actual conditions are reefs seeing or experiencing, and then it can help us disentangle episodic events like river flood events versus what the conditions are over the entire year. We'll look at some more data from the same event. So now we're looking at chlorophyll. So this is a measurement of how much phytoplankton is present in the water column. And you can see that at the river mouth site, phytoplankton levels are relatively low throughout the year. This is because phytoplankton, they need nutrients to grow, which is coming out of rivers in very high amounts, but they also need light. So at the river mouth, light levels are very low. We have a lot of sediment coming out. It's very turbid. So phytoplankton can't actually grow right there. However, if we look at the reef on Magnetic Island, we can see that during this flood event, we had a very significant phytoplankton bloom that occurred. So this is because there's high nutrients coming in from the catchment, and then light levels are high enough now that phytoplankton can bloom and grow in the water column. And these nutrients are not used just by phytoplankton. They're also used by macroalgae or brown algae that we see on coral reefs, which is actually competing with coral for space and light. If we look at a reef that's a little further away in the Palms group again, we can see that during the wet season, we do tend to have higher chlorophyll levels at this reef, but we don't see the kind of phytoplankton bloom that we saw in Magnetic Island. And again, this is because nutrients are being used up by plankton and other primary producers as water is moving, being transported along the coast. And also, this reef is in much deeper water that's further away from catchment influence. So we can also use these data to understand conditions over the long term, on average over the year. So if we average up our data over the entire year, we can see that in the 2018-19 year, we actually did have higher levels of turbidity and chlorophyll than we had in the previous year. So this demonstrates that although episodic events like river discharge events can be seem like they're short-lived, they can actually have influence over weeks, periods of weeks that add up to significant differences in conditions over the entire year. We can also use these data to relate them to things like water quality guideline values to demonstrate if reefs are meeting or exceeding designated water quality guideline values. So now I'm going to show some of the other biological data that we collect at the National Reference Station in Yongala. So this is out on the mid-shelf. And what you're seeing here is 10 years of plankton community data. So we're collecting plankton samples and then they're being identified. And the reason that we do this is because plankton are really the basis of marine food webs. So everything higher trophic orders, so fish, whales, everything above plankton really relies at its core on the plankton community. So we need to understand how phytoplankton communities change over time, and then understand if these changes are related to things like climate change or other pressures. So lastly, I'll talk about chemical variables that we monitor. We collect water samples for a very broad suite of chemical constituents. So on the right, Dan is showing how we collect dissolved nutrient samples. So this is basically refers to nutrients such as nitrogen and phosphorus that are so fine that they can pass through a very, very fine filter. So they're basically fully dissolved in the water. This would be things you may be familiar with: nitrate, ammonia, phosphate, as well as total dissolved nitrogen and phosphorus and silicate. So these are all important nutrients because they're used by phytoplankton to grow and also macroalgae to grow in the coastal, in the marine environment. We also collect particulate forms of these same nutrients. So that refers to material that is larger, so maybe larger pieces of nutrients. And these are all particles that do not pass through a filter. So I'm going to show now how we actually monitor these constituents in the field. So again, this video is from the Marine Monitoring Program. This work is being done on our smaller vessel, which is where we're normally working in the coastal zone. And when we're collecting water samples, we want to collect an intact water sample. We don't want to be pumping or disturbing the water in any way. So the team is using it's a spring-loaded bottle. It's called a Niskin bottle. So they're going to use this to collect an intact water sample at a specific depth. So Mike and Corinne are lowering the Niskin to whatever depth we need to collect a sample from. And then Mike is going to use this weight to trigger the bottle to close and collect a full water sample. So the Niskin is closed and it's collected a sample. And now the team will bring this back up and bring it on board and collect sub-samples from it. So they'll do dissolved nutrient sampling, like you just saw in that photograph where Dan was filtering nutrient samples. And they'll also collect particulate samples. So this is how we do this on the vessel. So we have an inbuilt filtration system, which is very cool on this vessel. Corinne is putting down these little white circles. These are filter papers. So it's basically a material with very, very fine pore size. And she's going to use this vacuum system to draw water through the filter. And then anything that's retained on the filter, we can then take back to the lab and analyze for particulate nitrogen, particulate phosphorus, total suspended solids, and chlorophyll A. So this is a really, it's really important that we do this out in the field. This is really minimizing the amount of effect that you might have from transporting samples or samples traveling anywhere. Mike is taking an exact volume of water from the Niskin so that we know exactly how much water we're measuring during this analysis. So now you'll see the vacuum system working. It's basically just drawing that water through the filter so that we can retain material on it and do our chemical analyses. Once the filtration is completed, Corinne is wrapping up the samples to make sure they're very clean and they can be frozen and they can be transported back to the lab for analysis. So we do monitoring like this at all of those MMP sites that you saw in the earlier site maps. And this monitoring is done between 3 and 12 times per year. We also collect organic carbon constituents and measurements of color dissolved organic matter, which is important for remote sensing or helping to validate remote sensing data. So now I'll just show a quick example of how we might use chemistry data. It's very important for understanding nutrient inputs, what the nutrient inputs are to the system, and then where the nutrients go. So what are the ecosystem processes that are happening? Where are the nutrients going? So in this example, we're looking at data from last year from the Russell Mulgrave, which is a river in the wet tropics region. And we're looking at nitrate. What you can see here is there's very distinct spatial patterns. So close to the river mouth, we have a lot of nitrate coming off of the catchment. Some of this is natural, so nutrients are naturally present in the marine environment and in rivers, but the amounts that are naturally present, nowadays we have much higher amounts, and this is from additional nutrient inputs in catchments, especially things like fertilizer, development, different land uses. So at the river mouth, we can see very high levels of nitrate coming out of the river. And then much further offshore in the mid-shelf, these nutrients are being taken up by phytoplankton and macroalgae and used when light is available. We can also see there's very distinct seasonal patterns in these in nitrate concentrations. So during the wet season, we have levels that are over 2 times greater than during the dry season. And that's because during the wet season, we have this period where there's much heavier rainfall, more frequent and heavier rainfall events. So this is washing catchment-derived material out into the coastal ocean. We can also use chemistry data to relate these to water quality guidelines to understand condition and trends that we're seeing in water quality. So we may choose specific indicators. For example, I'm showing chlorophyll A here, and this is just from one single site in the Whitsunday region. So water quality guidelines, we may have annual guidelines, or we may have seasonally specific guidelines. So we can look at all the water quality data collected over the year and assess whether they're meeting or exceeding water quality guidelines. And using that information, we can create things. This is an example below of what you could create. This is a water quality type of scorecard where we're taking all of our water quality and trying to bring it together into a communication product that allows us to communicate the condition in terms of many different water quality indicators over the entire year. So you may be wondering, how can I get access to these data? I want to explore these data. So all of our data in the Marine Monitoring Program is available online. We'll put up these web links after the talk in the chat box, so you'll be able to see them. So you can see here, this is what the data catalog looks like. There's a variety of different very exciting data products that are there for you to check out and explore. And this is one of our data records for the Marine Monitoring Program. So this is our logger network. So you can go on here, you can read about the data, look at the metadata, understand how it was collected, and download the data and use it for whatever your interest is. The same is true for IMOS. All IMOS data is publicly accessible on the Australian Ocean Data Network platform. So again, here's the web link that Kate will put up. And this is an example of what this looks like. So here we can see data records from the Yongala reference station. We have CTD profiles. So all of that information is present here. You can search for it. You can read about it. You can download it and use it for your interests. So I'd just like to take a minute to acknowledge all the people involved. These programs that I talked about today, this was a really, you know, quick overview of some really, really big and important programs that have been going on for many years. We're extremely fortunate to have really excellent partners that we work with in these programs, both the MMP and IMOF. So yeah, I just feel so lucky that we get to work with these guys. It's a really excellent program. Then within Ames, just, there's a huge team that's behind all of this work. So this includes people going out in the field and collecting the data, people calibrating the instruments, servicing the moorings, our lab staff who are truly excellent in processing samples, people that manage our databases. So it's a huge, huge team effort. So we're really just really fortunate that we have such a great team. Okay, and that's all from me. So if you have questions, go ahead and put them in that Q&A box. And we have about 15 minutes to answer questions. Thank you
so much, Renee. Exactly. We've actually got a few questions in there if you'd like to take some time to have a look.
Okay.
I did put those links to the Ames data catalog up and also the data network portal for IMOS as well. What also I might do is put up the MMP report link. I'll do that now. So if anyone's interested in the marine monitoring program reports, you can head to that link on the Great Barrier Reef Marine Park Authority website. They're there.
Oh yeah, I should have talked about that. So every year the marine monitoring program. So yeah, I'll quickly mention that before I answer questions. Thanks, Kate. So the marine monitoring program, this is just one arm of the marine monitoring program. There's also an entire branch that looks at the condition and trends of coral reef communities. Another whole branch looking at seagrass communities, and then yet another branch looking at pesticide concentrations in marine waters. So it's an even bigger program. Every year, all of this information is reported on. So if you go to that link that Kate has linked, you can find those reports and read them, check them out. There's so much, you know, really cool information in there. But yes, there's specific information on coral and seagrass communities as well. Okay, there's
all right, question time.
I'm gonna start getting into some of this. Okay, we have a question about why doesn't the Mackay region have any water quality loggers for increased water sampling? Is the pesticide passive samplers included in the map? So several questions in one there. The Mackay-Whitsunday region does have loggers. If you go on those web portals, you can download data from there. I believe we have three different moorings in that region. So there's plenty of data available, and it's you can download it on that web portal. Is this the reason for the increased water sampling? We like to have a lot of water sampling because you can never have too much chemistry data. So that's that. And then, is the pesticide passive samplers still included in the map? So the pesticide program I didn't talk about today, but there is a passive sampling and also grab sampling that occurs in the reef. And that is done through UQ with many other partners. I did not put those on the map. Ames is not involved in that sampling, but if you go and check out those reports, you can see all the information about the pesticide sampling program. Okay. Oh, somebody is asking about pesticide monitoring. So sort of answered that a bit. So yes, pesticide monitoring is carried out and has been since 2005. This is just the marine monitoring program I'm talking about. There is probably other pesticide monitoring that's happening as well. So yes, you can read about that information in those reports. Here's a question. Does nitrogen change much when it comes out of the rivers and out into the marine waters? So nitrogen is in, there's multiple forms that we monitor nitrogen in. So dissolved nitrogen would be things like nitrate and ammonia. And those are highly labile. So when I say labile, I mean they're rapidly used by plankton or primary producers so that they can grow. So when nitrogen is coming out in river discharge, those forms of nitrogen can be really rapidly used by phytoplankton, by macroalgae on coral reefs, so that's like brown algae, and other primary producers, including seagrasses. There's other forms of nitrogen that are longer, persist for longer in the marine environment. One form of nitrogen that we monitor is particulate nitrogen. So this would be, could be particles, nitrogen that is stuck onto sediment particles, or it could just be large pieces of nitrogen that are from, you know, dead material, organic material, any sort of organic material that's in the environment. And these can move around in the marine environment. They can be resuspended, so they can sit on the bottom, and then they can be mixed up by waves and tides up into the water column. And then the nitrogen can be, so this is, sorry about all these technical words. Hopefully you wanted to hear chemistry, technical chemistry language.
Irrelevant.
Yeah. So things like particle forms can be what we call remineralized. So that means that dead or organic material is being converted from those organic dead forms back into more free forms like nitrate and ammonia. And that can then be used again by phytoplankton. So that's what we call nutrient cycling. So the nutrients are really cycling through the environment. So once things like nitrate and ammonia are taken up by phytoplankton, they don't just leave and disappear. They don't just, you know, evaporate out into the air, or they're just gone and forgotten. They're still in the marine environment. So they get taken up by the plankton, then the plankton die and they become particulate forms. They may fall down to the bottom, and then they can be mixed up by waves and tides again and turned back into more labile forms. So that's what we talk about when we talk about nutrient cycling. It's really those cycles of things, of nitrogen and phosphorus, that's moving through the ecosystem. So hopefully that was a long answer to that question. Hopefully that was... here's a question about plastic pollution. Do you find that pollution, especially plastic pollution, may tamper with data that you collect? What do you do when this happens, and what are your solutions? So we don't find that plastic pollution or other types of pollution tamper with data that we collect, but I will say that there is some very cool monitoring of plastics that's starting to happen more in the reef space, and Ames is involved in that. So there's a researcher here, Dr. Frederica Kroon, who's leading a lot of plastic monitoring and plastic studies looking at plastics in the marine environment, especially microplastics. So that would be very, very small plastic fragments. So yeah, watch this space. There's starting to be more monitoring of plastics to understand the sources, so where they're coming from and where they're going, where they're ending up, and then impacts they may have on marine organisms.
And that monitoring is done in quite a different way, isn't it, for microplastics?
Yeah, that monitoring is done mostly by towing nets or taking net samples. So I didn't show any video of that, but we basically would take a net, a very, very fine mesh net, and we would tow it out in the ocean and then collect everything that is retained within this net. You basically rinse down and collect in a container, and then we can take that back to the lab and analyze it for what type of plastic it is, and try and understand where it's coming from. Okay, here's a question. Just wondering how much monitoring is done in the southern GBR. So yes, you would have noticed from that site map that most of our monitoring is located in the central and the northern GBR space. So at present, there is not, the marine monitoring program is not monitoring in southern GBR. Historically, the program did conduct monitoring in the Fitzroy region, so in the area of the Keppel Islands. But at present, that's not happening. But obviously, we would love to resume monitoring in the southern sector as well. That being said, there are many other groups that are collecting water quality monitoring, and I'm not an expert on exactly what all those different programs are, but things like the local marine advisory committees or regional bodies would be able to point you more in the direction of what types of monitoring is occurring. Here's a question. How different is the monitoring in freshwater bodies? So this is a good question. So the marine environment is, in many ways, the monitoring is similar to what we would do in a freshwater system, like a river or a lake, but in other ways, it's really quite different. So the marine environment is naturally adapted to very low concentrations of things like nutrients and suspended sediment. It has naturally much higher light conditions than inland waterways would tend to have. So because of that, we often monitor similar variables. So in a freshwater environment, we would also monitor things like nitrate and nitrite, phosphate, chlorophyll A. We would measure all those same variables, but we would just be looking at much higher levels than what we measure in the marine environment. So to do marine monitoring, we really have to have very specialized chemical and analytical techniques that we use to monitor these constituents because they are naturally at quite low levels.
Great questions in here, Renee. I don't think we're going to get to them all.
There's so many questions.
So what I might do, I might pop up your email address for the ones that we don't get. We've got time for a couple more. But for any we don't get to, and if people want to ask you, they can send it through to this email address. How's that?
That'd be great. Put on my email. And also, can you put on my Twitter handle if anybody...
No trouble.
I don't tweet very much, but...
When you do, it's great.
Sometimes I say something interesting, not very often.
The photos from the field are awesome.
Yeah, that's the best thing is what the field team's up to. That's very exciting. Here's a question about microbial monitoring. So does the Ames water quality monitoring also acknowledge any microbial aspects? So things like E. coli from sewage. So E. coli, or sometimes it's called fecal coliform, is a very common monitoring indicator in the very, very, very near shore zone. So if you were doing something like, if anybody here is involved with Beach Watch or programs like that are looking at very close to shore areas, beaches, harbors, marinas, places that are in experiencing a lot of very direct contact with human activity, you may monitor something like fecal coliform. The MMP monitoring is not occurring that close to shore. So things like fecal coliform is not something that we would be detecting in marine waters. By the time those inputs are reaching our sites, they would be pretty diluted by just mixing and general circulation in the lagoon. But yeah, if you were monitoring in a stream or a river or near a sewage treatment plant outflow, you would definitely monitor fecal coliform.
Maybe a couple more.
Have you considered monitoring the microbial community composition that might also affect water quality? Really good question. So there is another scientist at Ames, Dr. Nicole Webster, and she is really interested in understanding the microbial community, its diversity, and how the communities respond to different conditions out on the reef. So temperature, salinity, all types of environmental variables. So she is actually leading some programs looking at this exact question about the community composition and how it's related to water quality. And my team is involved in that. So that's a really exciting new area of research. So watch this space and look up Nicole. She has a lot of good information online, on Twitter, all kinds of places.
All right, last one.
Okay, one more. Someone has asked, how has COVID impacted monitoring work? So this is a really good time to just spruik how excellent our team here is at Ames, how excellent the community is at Ames and all of our partners in these programs. So COVID has really highly impacted the work that we do. You saw in those videos that we're working on very small vessels. Often most of our work is done on very small boats, and that would be the same for all of the marine monitoring program partners. So we obviously need to be very careful and not expose any team members to any type of risk while still trying to get out and collect data. So the team has worked very hard the last, since March, heavily risk assessing and putting lots of safety measures in place to make sure that we're still able to go out and collect all of our data, but that we're doing it in a safe way. So I would definitely say everybody's looking forward to, and I'm sure all of you are looking forward to the end of COVID-related disruptions. But yeah, on that note, I just would like to say also, I hope everybody is staying safe and staying well out there and is doing okay. And thank you for all of your questions. That's really
great. Yeah, they're being really good this morning. So I've put Renee's email address just on the chat. So hopefully you can all take it off that before we finish the webinar. So copy and paste if you need to right now. Thank you so much, Renee. That was a really great talk. And I think it's one of these really such interesting stuff that we don't always get to see exactly how you do it. So thank you so much for your time this morning. I think everyone's really enjoyed that. If you would like to stay in touch with AIMS, we have our Waypoint newsletter that comes out regularly. You can head to our website and sign up for that. You can also follow us on social media. We would love to share more of our science with you. So happy National Science Week, everybody. I'll just put up the Waypoint link there just before we leave. And there's also a great webpage about the water quality monitoring. So I'll put that up there. I'm full of links today. There we go. Lots of links for you to copy and paste right now. So just as Renee said, please stay safe, everybody. We've been really pleased to bring this these two webinars this week to you, this National Science Week. Enjoy the rest of your day, and thanks very much for coming. Bye.